As you can tell, we're going to be back in Isaiah chapter 35, looking at what the prophet is telling us. And it's been a little while since we've been in Isaiah, so I thought it would be helpful to go again over a question that people are bound to ask when you go through Old Testament books. People will say, well, aren't we living under the Old Covenant, so why do we spend so much time looking at books that are from the Old Testament? Well, when we look at this, we have to understand that I personally am not a New Testament Christian. I am a Bible Christian, and all of the Bible is mine, from Genesis to Revelation. I claim all of it. I own all of it. I believe all of it. I follow all of it. And when I say I follow all of it, I mean that in a very particular way, which we're going to talk about very briefly. But the reason why I am a Bible Christian and not a New Testament Christian is because of some of the things that are written in the New Testament letters. For example, in Romans chapter 1, when you look at what Paul has to say about Romans chapter 1, he claims, actually, not to be preaching anything new. What? Yeah, not anything new. Look at what he says. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. Well, I mean, yeah, okay, it was just kind of passingly mentioned. No, listen to what he says. Concerning his son, who is descended from David according to the flesh and was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith for the sake of his name among all the nations. He just claimed that all of that stuff was promised beforehand in the prophets. So pretty much everything that you could possibly think is connected with the gospel of Jesus is promised beforehand in the prophets. So what Paul claims to be doing is showing something that may have been hidden before, but has now been completely revealed, has been uncovered, and so now it is plain. And so he goes throughout the book of Romans. He goes throughout the book of Romans showing and quoting various places from the Old Testament, proving that the gospel of Jesus Christ is true, and in particular in that book, proving that we are not saved by works of the law. And so he uses the law and the prophets to show that salvation doesn't come from the law, but it comes through faith in Jesus as the Messiah. And so it's important that we see this because the prophets teach us about God's plan to save people. Right, we can see that again in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, where he talks about how he is making known spiritual truths that have been hidden before, but now he is laying them out. He is using spiritual words and instructing spiritual people. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, the Apostle Paul again writes to Timothy, telling him that he knew the scriptures from the time that he was a young person, which are able to make him wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. The scriptures that he knew from the time that he was a small child were the law and the prophets, right? What we call the Old Testament books. And it's important that we understand that all of them are ours. When we know how to use them the right way, that they all belong to Christians. The prophets teach us how God plans to move to a spiritual religion. There's this transition from a physical kingdom to a spiritual kingdom. It's very clear, I think, when you read through the Old Testament, that there was a spiritual kingdom, a physical kingdom. Right? You had a physical people who were brought from one physical place to another physical place. They had this whole lineage of kings. There are chronicles and books of these kings. They had physical boundaries. They had physical rules and ordinances. Well, at some point, with that physical kingdom, there has always been a spiritual kingdom. But at some point, God is going to move from the physical to the spiritual. And we have to have the law and the prophets to see how he was going to do that, so that when he begins doing it, we can see it and understand it. Stephen, will you please take her and just give her to Mrs. Rhodes? Thank you very much. Is that okay? Okay, thank you. My daughter's crying and my son is covering her face. That's never a good thing. So God at some point is going to move from a physical religion to a spiritual religion, and the law and the prophets, which first of all establish that physical kingdom, they also tell us that, hey, this physical kingdom isn't permanent. We are moving to something different, and these are the things that are going to happen when that takes place. That's incredibly important so that we can make sure that we're actually part of the right spiritual kingdom. Because there's more than one. There's at least two. Right? There's the kingdom of light and there's the kingdom of darkness. We want to make sure we don't kind of find our way into that dark one. We want to make sure that we're in the kingdom of light. And so we need the law and the prophets to show us how that happens. And in the New Testament, we can see that transition. And we see Jesus all the time referring back to, it is written. What does it say? We can see Matthew saying over and over again, this happened to fulfill what was written in the prophet. Because these things are important. They show us the spiritual religion. It is the spiritual information in the prophets that still applies today. And that's why I would claim to be a Bible Christian. Not because I think we have to offer sacrifices or that there's a special building somewhere that I have to go through or that there's a physical lineage for the priests anymore. I don't think any of that stuff happens. I don't think you have to follow the dietary laws. I don't think you have to follow the fashion laws, for lack of a better phraseology for that. I don't think you have to wear the tassels on the four corners of your garments, although I have met people who actually wear them. And that's kind of neat, because you know at least that they read their Bible. Right? But I don't think that those physical things apply anymore, because the point has always been to get to a spiritual kingdom. And it's this spiritual information in the law and the prophets that still applies today. When we look at this spiritual information, Amos chapter 3 and verse 7, which if you're not familiar with that, I would highly recommend that you acquaint yourself with Amos chapter 3 and verse 7. It says that God does nothing without revealing it to his prophets. And what that means is it means that God doesn't do anything big regarding the salvation of mankind that he doesn't tell us about. And the reason why God tells us about it is because it's regarding our salvation. And if we're going to be saved, we kind of need to know, you know, how God plans on doing that. And so he tells us when he's going to move from a physical kingdom to a spiritual kingdom. He tells us when he plans on moving in big and mighty ways. He lets us know that. And so we can see over and over that this spiritual information is there. In John chapter 5 and verse 39, Jesus says, you search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, but it is these that testify about me. Well, why would we toss out stuff that testifies about Jesus? That just doesn't make sense. Could you prove to someone, and this is why we need to study stuff like Isaiah, could you prove to someone that Jesus was the Messiah if you only had the Gospels in the Old Testament? You should be able to. You should be able to. There are 414, at least, 414 references, direct references to Christ in the Old Testament. Some of them are prophecies, some of them are just references, some of them are descriptions of what he will be like, of what the kingdom will be like. But there are 414 at least references in the Old Testament. Where was Messiah to be born? I see some people say Bethlehem. Yeah, you're right. Which Bethlehem? Ephrathah. Right, Bethlehem Ephrathah. How do you know that? Thank you, Micah. Micah chapter 5 and verse 2. That's a prophet, right? To whom was the promise of the Messiah? Let's word that a little bit differently. To whom were the results of the coming Messiah? To all nations. How do you know that? Thank you, Genesis chapter 22, where God tells Abraham, in your seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. That's the law. Right? So now we've shown that there is where the Messiah will be born, with a prophet. We're shown who gets to benefit from the Messiah, with the law. How do we get the promise? Will it be by the works of the law, or will it be by faith? Genesis chapter 15 and verse 6. And Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. That's the law. Right, so the law and the prophets, we're going to see this over and over. How would Messiah die? By crucifixion. How do you know? Deuteronomy 21 and verse 23, the law. How would Messiah save us? Through his death and resurrection. How do you know? Isaiah chapter 53, the prophets. This is again and again and again why it's important to study this stuff. Why we need to know the Old Testament and why we need to know what it says, because there is important spiritual truth there, and it's that spiritual information that still applies. It's that spiritual information that lets you know that Jesus wasn't just some loony running around in the first century who was somehow able to manipulate people into thinking that he was something that he wasn't. You have to know. If you are going to trust Jesus to save you eternally, then you had better know for certain that he is who he claims to be. You can't just take that on faith. Right? You have to know. And that is why God has given us his word, so that we can go through and see everything. But you need the whole Bible to do that. That's why we study Isaiah chapter 35, the book of Isaiah, the law and the prophets, is so we can know. So in Isaiah 35, what Isaiah 35 foretells is a new way, a new holy highway that God is providing. This is a really cool section. And we're going to start off, when we start digging into the text, we're going to move a little bit quickly. We could spend lots of time, but unfortunately we only have, I don't know, about 12 minutes left. So we're going to read through it, and then we're going to go over it pretty quickly and look at what it's telling us. This is a really cool section. This is something that every once in a while, just come back and read it and look at what God is promising us. So Isaiah chapter 35, verse 1, it says, "The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and blossom like the crocus." If your translation says rose, we'll talk about that in a minute. "It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given it. The majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. Strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who have an anxious heart, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, with the recompense of God. He will come and he will save you. The eyes of the blind shall be opened, the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap like a deer, and the tongue of the mute sing for joy. For waters break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert." You actually have to turn to the right page. "The burning shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. In the haunt of jackals where they lie down, the grass shall become reeds and rushes. And a highway shall be there, and it shall be called the Way of Holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it. It shall belong to those who walk on the way. Even if they are fools, they shall not go astray." If you have the New American Standard Bible or the NIV, I think those do a better job of rendering that there, saying something like, "Even fools shall not walk on it." That's what it should say. "Even fools will not walk on it. No lion shall be there, nor shall any ravenous beast come up on it. They shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there." Do you see why fools can't be there? Because a fool is somebody who rejects what God says, and you can only be redeemed if you accept what God says, and so fools can't be on this highway. But the redeemed are. "And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away." So here is this beautiful, beautiful picture that has multiple layers of application. You start going through it, and you look at this, and clearly, if you were an Israelite and you were being carried off to captivity, you would look at this and be hopeful that there was a way back. Right, so it definitely has multiple layers that we're dealing with here. This meant something to the people to whom the prophet originally delivered it. And it had a pretty physical connotation to them. It also has a spiritual connotation for them too. So what we're looking for as Christians is not the physical, but the spiritual. We want to know, what is this saying spiritually? Because we don't have the physical part of these promises. Right? There is no land to which God will bring us back. There is no literal highway upon which we will be walking. There's not some super 12-lane highway that God is going to construct from here to Wrigley Field, because we all know that maybe after College Station is the promised land on earth. So what does this mean, right? What does this mean? It means that the land would be restored after the people are punished. The land would be restored after people were punished. And the beauty of this land, when you're looking at this, the beauty of this land would return. When you listen to the descriptions of the Middle East, of Jerusalem and that surrounding area in particular, it's described like a garden. Right? They talk about, you know, there being flowing honey and all these beautiful plants where they're going. There were wild grape clusters as big as a man. Have you seen a picture of Jerusalem lately? It's like a giant sandbox. Right? Because the land was punished again. All of the beauty and all of the wonderful things that made it a place to be, that was all taken away because they didn't listen to God again. Right? But the promise is that God is going to restore these physical people back to this physical place, and it's going to be beautiful again. But the spiritual meaning of this is that there is a beauty that is coming, and we get to be part of it, and it involves this thing called a crocus. Right? Unless you really like flowers, you probably don't know what a crocus is. And even if you know what a crocus is, do you know what that word meant in 700 BC? My answer to all of those things was no, so I had to look it up. It's what we might call meadow saffron. It is the closest modern flower. It's this beautiful lily-like flower that has these vibrant hues of purple and magenta and gold. It's just an absolutely gorgeous flower. In fact, it's so beautiful that in the Song of Solomon, the beloved is called the lily of the valley. It's the same flower. And we sing a song talking about Jesus, and we call him the what? He is the lily of the valley, right? He's this beautiful flower that dots the countryside and makes it just gorgeous with purple and gold, all of which are royal colors. Right? So there's this beautiful purple and gold flower that covers the countryside in this area, and God claims that he is going to bring it back. Well, this lily of the valley is Jesus. So whatever we're seeing here, this beauty that is going to really be fulfilled, this beauty is going to come with the Christ. He is the one who will bring this beauty. Israel was a wasteland spiritually, and they needed to be revived by God. They needed God to come and make them better. And God is going to do that by sending his son. He's going to bring back Israel ultimately. And we can see Paul making reference to the Israel of God in the New Testament. That's us. We are the Israel of God. Everybody who will come to Christ in faith is the Israel of God. And we are made beautiful through him and by him and for him. And so that's what this is looking forward to. Another thing we see is that in verses 3 and 4 especially, is that God is going to save his faithful remnant. God is going to save his faithful remnant. And that meant that if you were carried off into captivity, that not everybody who's carried off is going to come back. Not everybody who is in Israel was going to even be carried off. Right? The faithful people were carried off, and then in captivity, the faithful people were brought back. Some of the faithful people were brought back. We can say that. And so God is promising that these people who were made weak would be made strong again. You can see over in Romans chapter 9 and verse 6, the Apostle Paul making an argument that not all who are from Israel are Israel. Right? Not everybody who has this physical lineage is actually part of Israel, because not all of them are faithful. So these faithful people are going to be redeemed. And what we see then is who is the faithful one? What does it take to be faithful? Well, you can read in places like Ezekiel chapter 18, where it talks about the one who does righteousness. That is the person who is faithful. And Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 4, it says, "And the righteous shall live by faith." In other words, it's the person who comes to God in faith that is righteous. This is why the argument is made in the New Testament that we are justified by faith. Because these people are carried off. None of them are perfect. And the ones who are brought back aren't perfect according to the law. But they are faithful to God. In other words, they want to do what God says. They want to know what God says. They want to put what God says into practice. And so the question you have to ask yourself when you start looking at your life is not, have I lived a perfect life according to the law, but am I a faithful person to Christ Jesus? And if you define faithfulness by always doing what God says, you have just defined faithfulness as the works of the law. That's not what faithfulness is. Faithfulness is coming to God and seeking God and loving God and desiring to do what God says, even though sometimes we fall woefully short of that. And so the idea of faithfulness is that, yes, you might sin, but you didn't want to. You don't want to. You want to be different. You want to do what is right. You want to come to God, and you want to always do the right thing. See Romans chapter 7. Right? That's what we're looking at here, these faithful people, and God promises to strengthen them. And not only to strengthen them, but to take vengeance on their enemies. And so when this kingdom comes, there is going to be the salvation of some and the judgment of others. There is going to be the salvation of God's faithful people, and there's going to be the judgment of Satan and his servants and sin and death. On the last day, there will be the salvation of the faithful and the judgment of the faithless. And so we see these days of salvation are days of judgment for others. So God promises to save his faithful remnant. He promises to repair and heal what was broken by sin in verses 5 through 7. That's really good news. Because this is what makes it possible for us to see and think and understand like God, is when he fixes us. When we sin and we become wed to this world and death, we can't really think like God. But when he comes and saves us and redeems us and fixes us and shows us this new and better way, he makes it possible again for us to see and think like him. He makes it possible for us to have peace and joy in his salvation. In verse 6, he gives us new life. In verses 6 and 7, you can see that in places like Romans chapter 6. If we are buried, therefore, with Christ Jesus, we shall also be raised with him to a newness of life. And then it finishes with this cool picture, this pathway back to God being opened. In the New Testament, the Christians called themselves followers of the way. You want to take a guess where they got that from? Isaiah chapter 35. Right? The word way, almost universally, English Bibles translate as the way in the New Testament. That's because the highway sounds a little funny to our ears. Right? Unless you're from California, because they do like the 10, the 45. So the highway makes sense to people from California. But for people in Texas, we're like, no, not the highway. It's just a highway. But in the New Testament, the Christians were followers of the highway. Which one? The highway of holiness that you can read about in Isaiah chapter 35. They knew that God had come in the flesh. And they knew that God had established this pathway back to him. And when Jesus says to his disciples, I am the way, he was clearly making a reference back to this, stating that if you want all of these things that I'm talking about, all of these things that God has been promising, it's me, right? I am the highway back to God. I am the highway back to holiness, to peace, to eternal life. Everything that you want, it's me. Everything that the prophets have been talking about, it's me. Right? That's why he says in John chapter 5, you search the scriptures thinking that in them you have eternal life, but it's them that testify about me. He's not only the way, he's not only the truth, he is also the life. And no one gets to the Father except through him, because he is the highway of holiness. And if we don't know Isaiah, when Jesus says stuff like that, we miss it. If we don't know Isaiah, when the Apostle Paul says, I am being persecuted because I'm a follower of the way, we miss what he's saying. It's so beautiful, it's so rich, it's so amazing how everything in the Bible is connected through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is blessed in the highest ways possible forever and ever. Amen. Thank you so much for your attention. At this time, we'll be dismissed from class.